All right, man. Welcome back to the good old US of A.
Thank you. It feels nice to be back. I have to admit, I'm wearing a t-shirt from my favorite local coffee shop here in town. Because let me tell you, Pat, it's been a high caffeine couple of days trying to chase the jet lag away after getting back from France. So here we are.
I was going to say, as we record this, it's Wednesday, May 22nd. Right
feels
now,
like a
and
Thursday.
So you just got back from France for week one of the semifinals.
That is correct. Yeah, week one of the semifinals kicking off, and it was a great competition out there. Shout out to the French Throwdown they hosted this year, and they did an amazing job of doing two things. They were kind of serving two masters, in the sense that they had the CrossFit Games semifinal running on one competition floor at the same venue in the secondary field of play. They hosted a community competition and they had, you know, 500 plus athletes competing there.
That's legit.
On the community level. Yeah. And the energy in there was amazing. They had to turn people away at one point because they had they had enough people there that they were starting to max out what the fire marshal would allow them to hold in that venue. So that was really cool. Always great when people come out and turn out for the community athletes just as strongly as they do for the big dogs. So cool to see.
How's your French?
Well, you know, I can speak sûrement un petit peu, Pat.
I was going to say, getting back to your, are you Canadian? You French Canadian?
Not French Canadian, no. So I grew up on the West Coast, and that's
okay.
About as far away from French Canada as you can be. But I did take it in, you know, middle school and high school, and typical, you know, kid at that age. I didn't see value in it. And now that I'm older, I'm like, man, I wish I would have taken that a little bit more seriously.
100%.
Because it would be really cool to have that skill. But
100%.
Anyway, so
our goal today is just gonna, you know, we like to chat programming, things that help coaches, fitness enthusiasts, all that good stuff. So there was a bunch of events that went down for the semifinals. We're going to chat semifinal events. But before we do that, do the housekeeping here. Everybody, go to varied.random.com. Check out all the different cycles that we offer. There's three more in the works. I won't say what they are right now in case one gets delayed, but there's three more being added. And actually some ones that we've had for a while, we're updating and making them even better. But there's all kinds of ones with barbell, running, gymnastics, you name it. Get your first strict handstand push-up, pull-up. So check those out. Help support the show. And then if you own a gym, any sort of gym, CrossFit, powerlifting, Olympic lifting, just a fitness studio, you got to take care of workout tracking so people know they're actually getting fitter. You need to manage your gym. You need to do billing. And BTWB has all of those things covered in one solution. So go to btwb.com/all-in-one and find out more and get yourself on the list and you'll be good to go. So for the semifinal events, you were the lead programmer behind those. Is that fair to say?
That is correct. I was responsible for writing those that series of workouts. And, you know, of course, it's not like you were saying off camera earlier, no man is an island, Pat, and that's very true when it comes to big events like this. So yeah, it was my job to do the drafting of those and take the first crack and ultimately make some decisions around that. But it gets filtered through the team, it gets bounced off of El Jefe, Dave Castro, you know, and so there's a lot of different inputs that get us to the end stage. But yeah, at the root of it is my job to put them together.
So just to inform the viewers and listeners out there, we're going to walk through the six different events and you're going to hear right from the horse's mouth from Adrian when what was percolating in his mind, why was this particular workout, whatever, time domain, loading, apparatus, whatever it was, like, you know, what was the thought process behind it? Because, you know, they're not random nonsense, you know, contrary to popular belief, there's intent and purposeful decisions driving these things to make sure that you test what you want to test. We're going to get to hear that from Adrian. And then the only other thing that I'll say is sorry to disappoint everybody out there. If you've been listening to the show for however long it's been now, 160 something episodes, hopefully you know the general themes what we're talking about. So the point of this show is not for somebody in the comment to say, well, I was watching in heat two, lane number three. What happened with this athlete and this penalty? Sorry, everybody. Sorry to disappoint you. That's not what we talk about here. There's plenty of other formats for that. We're going to talk about the program. So with that being said, there were six events, and I mean, do you want to touch on like a broad thing to start off? Or you just want to like go right into event number one?
Well, I mean, up to you. I think that, maybe
I guess well, what was, when you sit down with a blank slate,
yeah,
and you're like, okay, semifinals is coming up, do things just come to you as need be, or do you have some systematic approach? I mean, what, you know, on that one, we're like, well, my to-do list today is to start thinking about the semifinal events. You know, where do you start?
Well, there's kind of two answers to that question. And I'll start by backing up and saying that, yeah, I think you and I have talked about this a few times when we talk about programming. And for anybody out there who's doing any level of programming, whether it's, hey, I got to go out and do my own workout in the garage today, or I'm doing this for my affiliate or whatever, that to me is always one of the hardest things to do, is to have that open playing field with limitless possibilities and saying, all right, where do I plant my first flag? Overcoming that can be pretty difficult. So I always look for ways to try to get that process started more quickly, because once I get one, it's so much easier to get 2, 3, 4, and 5.
Get the ball rolling.
Exactly. And then before you know it, you have too many ideas, and now you got to start cutting some of them away to get to the really good ones. So all that to say, the kind of two things that I started with for this year's semifinals was, number one, I have an ongoing document that I've started a while back now, where it has ideas and workouts that were rejected from previous competitions. So whether that's the Open or the Games or any stage of competition, really, I have kind of a running list of things that didn't make the cut previously.
A scrap pile in a lumber yard, you know?
Exactly. It's always kind of nice to go, yeah, you pick through the pile and you're like, ooh, that's an interesting piece. What can we do with that? Maybe that fits the project. So that was one thing that I started looking at. And then secondarily, for the competitive season, you know, we're always kind of looking at what was the last stage of competition featuring, and by extension, what did we not get to do? Because, you know, you only have so many workouts to choose from. What didn't get addressed really well at that last stage of competition, and can we add it in the next one? So those were the two kind of strategies I used to start the programming. And that ended up, honestly, the first workout of the competitive weekend was the first one that got committed to paper. It just kind of happened that way. It doesn't always happen that way, but it did this time.
Okay, so in those two things that you just said, do you recall off the top of your head when you looked back as to, like you said, previous phase of the season, something that maybe didn't get the love that we'd like to have given it, and now we're going to emphasize it now? Do you remember what one of those things was?
Yeah,
that you
wanted for sure. I mean, running was like the big shining beacon. And that's pretty common as we get into the in-person stage of the season, because frankly, you just can't really do running very well in an online competition. It's hard to do and for it to be fair across the field, given the variance that people have to deal with, you know, their own different running layouts.
Sure.
Given the way that you can record that and trust that people are doing the distances that they're supposed to. There's a lot of problems with that in an online format.
Trust.
They get resolved really quickly when we're on site and we can have everybody run the same thing. I'll go back even to last year. And, you know, last year we had some running at the semifinal stage. It was all done on the air runners, which, hey, that's a great substitute if that's what you have. Mm-hmm. But in my opinion, there's no better way to test that kind of basic aerobic stamina and endurance than to get people out there pounding the pavement. And that was a decision that we had made kind of at the end of last season, was, all right, when we get to the semis this year, we're going to make sure that everybody's running and they're going to actually run, not running on an air runner, not some other kind of simulated run, but a real deal, get outside, let's make a track and get after it. So that was the basis. Yeah.
Oh, interesting. Okay. Oh, that's interesting, because when we haven't talked about the events yet, but on event number one, it has the run. I just assumed it was in an air runner.
No, sir. We put them out there.
Yeah. Oh, that's really, really cool. Okay. Before we get to that, the other point that you mentioned, I don't know if you have something that sticks in your head, that you're rummaging through the odds and ends through the scrap pile, right?
Yeah.
And, you know, is there something now that looks different at this phase? And I'm sure there are some things that you pull out or workouts that you're seeing, you're like, this is beautiful as is, or it's not, but it sparks a thought that leads to something else, which is good. Do you happen to remember looking through that list and what kind of caught your eye? And was it good as is, or was it just the inspiration you needed to go somewhere else?
Mostly the second, so more the inspiration. I didn't find anything in the stack that I wanted to pull out exactly, but what was really clear was that we needed combinations of gymnastics and monostructural movements. So to paraphrase your tagline there, not a barbell in sight.
Put a glimmer in my eye right there.
Yeah, exactly. And so it was obvious that those pairings were something that needed to be highlighted at this stage, given what had been done at the Open and the quarterfinals. And so there were a couple workouts in the scrap heap that had those pairs but weren't quite right, but they started generating some ideas for what ultimately became events 3 and 4.
Okay.
So, yeah.
All right. Very cool. And how much time do you give yourself to get these things right? You know, you got to come up with six events. How far in advance do you start focusing on this so that you're not like rushed and panic stricken at the end to get them out the door?
Yeah, good question. For this stage of the season, you know, there's a lot that goes into planning a live event. And not to get too behind the scenes about this, but the hardest part about this stage of the season particularly is that you actually have 7 events. And, you know, we partner with event organizers in each of the 7 regions. They have their own staff. They have their own set of volunteers. They have sometimes their own back of the house systems that they like to run. And so with all of that considered, the hardest part of this stage is replicating something across all of those different regions. Mm. All that to say, you need quite a bit of lead time to let people know the plan so that they can execute on it. So this is like semifinals is one of those stages where you can't be up to the wire because there's just way too many elements that have to be in place for you to be able to pull it off successfully across all those 7 regions. At the games, it's actually kind of surprising, but you have more latitude to be kind of right up to the wire because it's literally a one-off unique event where there's quite literally an army of people willing to just shift on a dime and do what needs to be done should you pivot at the last second. That's not possible when you have to disseminate that to 7 different regions with 7 different staff pools and 7 different experience levels, et cetera, et cetera. So anyway, making the case that, you know, semifinal planning is early, or at least as early as we can. And we had these workouts pretty much dialed in January of this year. That was kind of the final testing that we did was in January. Prior to that, so, you know, this is the end of 2023, is when I had committed a lot of these to paper. Dave and I had gone back and forth quite a bit on them. I took them to my competition team. We had ironed them out as close as we could. And then we got to that January testing, did some testing with the athletes, and then that's where we start putting the final stamp.
And going into this planning process, do you already know that you want 6? Are you going to see how many it takes to achieve your results? Or, you know, how do you land on 6?
Yeah, great question. That's a kind of historical precedent to some degree. That's around the sweet spot for this stage that we've seen in the past. And then, yes, it's kind of, okay, how do we get enough of what hasn't been tested or enough of what fits together well to create a comprehensive test where we can say, yes, this is enough to send the best people forward as a qualifier. So, yeah, 6 was kind of a nice place to start looking at some other things, you know, competition schedule overall, stuff like that. It worked out with 6. But, yeah, that was the sweet spot there.
Okay. Well, let's dive right into event number 1.
Let's do it. Yeah.
And now, like that I know, one, huh? Now that I know there was a real run, yeah.
Even better?
Yeah. So event number 1, 5 rounds for time, an 800-meter run, and then 10 clean and jerks, 185 for the men, 125 for the women. And, you know, we were chatting before the camera clicked on. You know, I had a sick kid this weekend, vomit and all this stuff. I was totally out of touch with the world. So I didn't watch anything going on. And I just knew, I knew of this event because somebody posted in Linchpin that they were just in love with this event and their mind was blown with how fast people were knocking it out. Oh. So this was the really one that I had a sense of. And I mean, come on. I mean, 5 800-meter runs. I mean, I love the barbell stuff as well, but you got to work out with 5 800-meter runs tucked in there. Now that I know that it really happened on planet Earth, that's glorious, man. But chat with us about this one.
Yeah, no, it was a lot of fun. And so each region has a unique run course, obviously, because their venues are different and the restrictions that they have within those venues are different. So in France, we had this outdoor run that weaved its way through some of the vendor area, actually. Mm. We cordoned that off for that part of the competition. So they were running through the vendor area and it kind of looped back on itself to make the distance and snaked into the Coliseum where they would come back to the barbells and lift. And so what's even more mind-blowing to me about the athletes that placed in the top of this, you know, we're talking approaching sub 20 for this entire workout, which is
crazy. Insane.
We're talking about 2.5 mile run on top of 50 clean and jerks at a heavier than grace loading, which is pretty crazy. But what's even crazier is that, you know, that run was not like a beautiful, no slowing down, perfect track that allows...
When you said weaving through vendor, that's the first thing I thought of.
Yeah, there's a couple of switchback areas in there. There's some forced starting and stopping because of those tight kind of hairpins. And so, yeah, the fact that you have to decelerate and accelerate, it's not just the straight shot around the track, makes that even more impressive in my mind, because you can't just settle into your pace. You have to navigate the course as well. So super impressive to see how these athletes did it.
I mean, just to think for anybody at home, right? 5 rounds, 800 meter run, 10 clean and jerks, 185 or 125. If the fastest people out there were, let's just say around, you know, 20 minutes, you said, you know, really close to that, they're holding about 4 minutes per round, which for a lot of people, they're happy just to run the 800 in 4 minutes, let alone you got to do 10 clean jerks. And then with that level of fatigue, hit it again and again. Yep. And again, when people ran in to the barbell, was quick singles the deal? Were people holding on with the heroes? What was going on?
You know, it was interesting. You saw, I think some people came out pretty conservatively and they're doing the quick singles. And I think that strategy held up pretty well. But often on the last round, what you'd see is people come back and then try to hit that last one unbroken. Mm. There were some notable exceptions, though, where you had a couple of people that were touch and go from the beginning. And it was so fun to watch that. They would come in, rip a set of 10, and then be right back out on the run course. That was pretty awesome.
Man.
Yeah.
It's just, this is just another one of those events that it's just amazing how far athletes have come in a relatively short period of time. And this event would have buried every competitor in the field, you know, X amount of years ago. and now it's at semifinals and people are touch and go on the barbell. And anyway, so super impressive.
So to talk about this one, just, you know, all I could think about were some of like Greg's old words about, okay, when you know you've hit the sweet spot in a workout is when the little guy comes up to you after class and says, hey, there's too much lifting and it was too heavy in this workout. And in the same workout, the big guy comes up to you in class or after it's done and says, hey, you know what? There was way too much running in this workout. And when they both have that kind of, polarizing gripe in the same session, you're like, I got it. That's the one. And so that was kind of what we were aiming for here.
And did this one, you know, sometimes workouts shake themselves out with less effort than others. Mm-hmm. Did this one do that? Did you have a bunch of back and forth and fits and starts about the loading and things like that?
I mean, there was a little bit of back and forth with the loading. We had started with it heavier, to be honest. It was originally programmed at 225. And with less reps. But looking at how it sat across the rest of the workouts in the series, it was a little too similar in terms of loading. We start to look at the whole weekend and it starts to bias more towards the strength-oriented athlete a little bit too much. And so we took the heat off of that. And what it became was really just like a foot on the gas for 20 minutes type of effort rather than, okay, I really have to pace this and think about the strategy. Obviously, that was still part of it, but much less so than when you're confronted with a barbell that's got that stopping power behind it.
Yeah, I mean, for this level of athlete at this phase of the competition, I like that because I think it makes them go like, darn it. Like, I almost wish that it was heavier because you'd give me a reason to slow down a bit on the run because I'd have to, but now I can't, you know, but I also can't slow down on the clean and jerks, but they're going to sting like,
yeah.
Oh, so anyway, that's beautiful. Okay. Gorgeous. Did you have good weather for the running outside?
We did. And it was kind of funny because Thursday, which was the prep day for the competition, it was rainy and ugly and everybody's kind of worried about it. And then Friday when it was game time, it was beautiful and sunny. And so it worked out really well, but it wasn't looking good for a minute there. So.
Were you about to say something else for it before you
moved on? I was going to say too, which is kind of unique about this year's competition, was that was the only event for these athletes on Friday. So not only was it, you know, the longer event where you're going to have to go longer than you probably want to racing your competitors that, you know, are pushing you on both ends of that. But you also don't have the excuse in your mind that like, well, I got to save something for the next event today. There was no other event that day. So it really was a, hey, first event out the gate. You shouldn't have any fatigue coming into the competition. If you're doing it right, should be fresh and ready to go. And there's nothing coming at the tail end of it. So you got to unload the tank and just put it all out there. Yep.
I like it. And obviously at that level, everybody's just, you know, power clean to right overhead.
Oh, yeah.
You know, which is why we've got an event two. Now we'll go ahead and get below parallel.
Yes, you know, we will.
We've got a robust loading on the bar, 2.25 for men, 155 for women, especially when you consider that for those front squats, it's going to be 5 sets of 10 at that loading. And each round's got starting off with 100 double unders, then 20 toes to bar to get your attention, and then 10 front squats, 5 times through. So 500 dubs, 100 toes to bar, and then 50 front squats at that loading. That is a beast.
Yeah. This workout, it really was interesting during testing because we put this one out there, or I put this one out there to a few people that we have kind of trusted to test things remotely on their own and then kind of report back. So we did a lot of that with this workout before we got on site for our final testing. And what was interesting is everybody that did it initially had the same result where they felt great for the first two rounds and then something happened. Around round three, and things significantly slowed down, which I think makes perfect sense when you're talking about sets of 10 on a heavy front squat. All of a sudden, that's going to catch up with you, and you know it's going to be a rough ride. But I'll also say that this one, I think, highlights a theme that starts to come out throughout the rest of the competition, which is these sets of each movement, while they're aggressive, they're also doable for athletes at this level. And the athlete is kind of having to flirt with, I know I can do it unbroken. I know the best might be doing it unbroken. Should I do it unbroken? And is that best for me? And so you have to kind of make a decision here. And again, you know, you see the best, like a lot of them did do this unbroken and it wasn't a problem for them necessarily, but it's right on the line for a lot of people, especially as you get into those later rounds.
Yeah, I mean, this, and I think that the sets of 20 toes to bar are just sneaky, you know, set after set after set. You know, that's 5 sets of 20 like that. That's big chunks of work for the old midline there. That's just one of those things. You just don't recover your wind, you know, while you're doing toes to bar. Yep. And then you're after the dubs, then you're going to grab this miserable barbell from the ground and you want to stabilize your midline, but you haven't recovered your breathing. Like, that's just a nasty combo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. And I think that return to the rope, same thing. You know, I think that front squat really starts to spike your heart rate, get you in that, you know, kind of fight
all
or flight mode.
And then,
And then, you know, you don't have that kind of steady breathing ready for the double unders as soon as you want to.
Man, I think of a workout like that, and I think of people that test it. I think of Joe Alexander right off the top. That's just
on account of his steel calves. Is that
100%? that's a dirty. So this kicked off Saturday, event number two.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. and again, this was a classic gymnastics monostructural weightlifting combination. Try to get something represented from all three of those movement domains. Try to make sure each one of them is given its due, you know, and sometimes double unders are done in much smaller numbers. I wanted this to be a significant metabolic effect. Mm-hmm. So those sets 100 had to be part of the deal.
Yeah, man.
Not going to get away with a set of 20 or 50 or something.
The old heavy day at the high heart rate there. Was there a lot of iterations leading to this that you remember, or did that shake out
pretty
well?
This one was pretty much set out of the gate. Really, the only conversation that had to have a lot of kind of polish on it was time cap for this particular event.
Man, that's and the crowd loves that. So if they see 225 or 155 coming off the floor, that's they're happy about that.
I think it's cool too that that weight for a front squat. It's heavy, no doubt. You know, it's not a comfortable weight for most of us. Mm-hmm. But it's also something that I think a lot of people that are enthusiasts of CrossFit, like they have lifted that weight. Maybe it's closer to your one rep max.
Sure.
Maybe you're not doing sets of 10, but people know what 225 feels like on that rack trying to get it out of the hole.
They respect it.
Absolutely. Yeah. And when you got 50 of them to do, you know, it's a different thing.
Was it three events on Saturday, 2, 3, and 4?
No. So this is where it gets interesting. So the competition format this year, 1 on Friday, 2 on Saturday, 3 on Sunday.
Okay. Okay. Yep. Interesting. All right, cool.
And while we're at it, if you look at it too, what's kind of interesting is the way it lays out. So 1 Friday, 2 Saturday, 3 Sunday, which sets up Sunday to have a lot of points on the table. Mm-hmm. And it's closer to a game style day where you have 3 events. It's a lot of volume. The events also get faster from start to finish. So the longest event was up front and they get continuously faster until you get to the final, which was the shortest and sweetest.
That's cool. Okay. Very cool. Yes. Cause that first one, event 1 had a 30-minute time cap. Event 2 had an 18-minute time cap. And now as we move on to event number 3, this has a 16-minute time cap. And this would be, well, it's event 3, the second and final event of Saturday, of day number 2. And so for event number 3, you're not going to need a barbell at all. You had a great barbell for event 1 and event 2. So now 7 rounds for time, 10 calories in the echo bike, 1 legless rope climb, 10 box jump overs, 1 legless rope climb. So 7 rounds, 2 legless rope climbs per round split up with those box jumps. So you're going to wind up getting, by the end of this workout, 7 sets of 10 calories on the echo bike, 7 sets of 10 box jump overs, and then a total of 14 legless rope climbs, 15 feet. But was that just run and jump to the rope?
I gotta correct you there. It's actually 13. So the small caveat to this is that the way it lays out on the competition floor, if you think you have the bike on one side behind the rig, you have the box on the far side of the field, basically the rope climb is in between them. And it acts as a gate. So every time you pass through the gate, you have to owe a rope climb.
Okay.
Yes. So on that last pass through, you do your rope climb after you come off the bike, you get to the box jump overs, and then you run to the finish. So on that last round, there's a bit of an asterisk there.
Gotcha.
That there is no rope climb on the final round.
Okay. So 13.
There's no rope climb after the box jump. So yes, 13.
Yep. 13, okay. 13 legless rope climbs. Was that with the short rope, can I assume? Or how was that like?
Not the short rope. It was, just the regular rope with no coil on the ground.
Gotcha.
But legless rope climb, regular old
and
length.
The height on the box jumps, 30 inches for men, 24 inches for women. And was that a jump on the box, jump over, or like a jump over the box?
Jump on the top and step down.
Okay,
The athletes had the option to jump over should they want
jump
to do
over
that.
Every time, you know what I mean?
Why wouldn't you, right?
Legs feel so good after the 5 sets of 10 front squat.
Save a little time. Why not? Just go for it.
So, I mean, this is one of the ones which I always like looking at and I like watching because, I like to look at what I think anyway most people it would put a small little frown on most people's face. You know, people love heavy weight. They love all that stuff. They see this and there's no weight whatsoever. And they're like, probably like, dang it. This one's going to be a stinger. Cause they always are, they're always more deceptive than you think. So what was your intent, leading into this workout? And then how did you arrive at the 7 rounder here?
Yeah, quite honestly, again, going back to what I said earlier, it's a monostructural and gymnastics combination that needed to be kind of a keystone of this stage of competition. So that was a big one. And I love a legless rope climb, but I also like a legless rope climb where it's not going to be the only linchpin in the workout, meaning, you get to a point where you just can't do it and you're sitting there staring at the rope. That's often the case when you get into some of these higher skill type of movements where there's such a bottleneck that it's either, you know, you can get through that bottleneck or you can't. I wanted this to have the element of that difficult movement, but at the same time, it was all gas and no brakes. So for competitors at this level, that volume of rope climbs isn't going to be a significant factor. Maybe some people down the leaderboard, sure, but for the people that are going to be racing this, it is all engine. There is no slowing down on this, and you have to attack at every single part of it.
Well, that's interesting to hear, because I was going to say, when I looked at this, my initial impression was, oh, Boz wanted him to go. Like, it's yes. time to go. Because if
exactly
you,
right.
if you go yep. back to the overall volume of work, you know, to oversimplify it, you could have done this chipper where, okay, we're going to do 70 mm-hmm. calories on the bike, followed by 70 box jump overs, followed by 13 legless rope climbs. Same volume of work, totally different with regards yep. to pacing and stuff. But now, almost like Cindy, right? Why Cindy's so devious yep. compared to like Angie. You know, like you're giving just 10 calories on the bike. That's all I'm asking from you. Mm-hmm. Just 10 box jump overs, like you got to go, 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 and that transition, that speed. So yeah, it's like, okay, we're going to knock all this out and you're not going to dilly-dally.
Yeah, for sure. And this is one of my favorite workouts of the weekend. And also one of the ones that after the testing was done, when we did our testing week, you know, we send the athletes home and we're kind of like, okay, no, nobody's looking. Let's take a crack at some of these. This was one of the ones that we did with some of the staff. And I'm not too proud to boast a little bit that I beat the time cap on this one. So
good for
happy.
You.
Yeah, I was happy about that. And even for somebody at my level, which is not amazing, that's what it translated to. It was a gas tank workout, full stop. I was just breathing heavy the whole time, heart rate through the roof. No reason to slow down on any of it because there's just not that much at each station. So you have to keep the foot on the gas.
Not to put you on the spot, but do you remember, out of just total curiosity, for some of the people who did well on this, what were they pacing out? Like, how long was 10 calories in the bike taking them?
Oh, that's a good question. I don't know their splits, but I know that, again, the faster times, they were like sub-9, I believe.
Okay. Oh, wow. Oh, wow.
I believe. Don't quote me on that.
Sure. Okay. Yeah. But I get to figure that's such just a... It's an insignificant yet significant number of calories. Like it's small enough that you want to not pay it mind, but then you get on after the fatigue that hits you and you realize you have to pay it some mind. You know, like it's kind of a, yeah. it's a yep. it's a cool deal that fits in well with everything else. And did this yeah. materialize?
Man, now I got to look it up.
Curious?
Sorry, I just got to give it, yeah. I should remember this, but.
Well, let's think here for a second. I mean, that's cooking, but these people are so fast that it's, you know, certainly possible.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say they're on the bike.
Give me two seconds.
Yeah, I'm trying to do it in my head here, up and down the rope fast. I mean,
yeah, here we go. So the winner on the men's side, 9:19. So I misspoke a little bit.
Wow.
Just over 9 minutes, but yeah.
Wow. So that's like, what is that? Like a ballpark 90 seconds per round? Because 7 times, that would be 9:30. So yeah, like, literally like 1:30 per round ish. Wow, that's absolutely you cannot take your foot off the gas at all. That's impressive. Mm-hmm. And that shook out largely in a way that made you smile, came out just how you wanted it to.
Oh yeah, great races. I mean, really tight back and forth, and a lot of the athletes that, you know, kind of had to push themselves a little beyond maybe what they had hoped for. Once you're looking left and looking right and seeing people pass you by.
And are the days gone where there were some people that had the legless rope climbs and other people that just, you know, took them out of the race or whatnot? Or these days, everyone's just got it all day long and not an issue? Or was the legless rope climb, even the way that you split it up, something which kind of stopped some folks?
A little bit different when we're talking men's versus women's competitors. So on the men's side of the house, it was not really an issue. It was, you know, you got to keep mm-hmm. your foot down on the pedaling and on the box jump overs to make up some good time and just keep motoring through. On the women's side, particularly a little bit further down the leaderboard, those rope climbs became more significant.
Gotcha. That makes perfect sense. Okay. Yeah. So they go to bed, they sleep well Saturday yep. night, and they get up now for 3 events for the final day of competition. And each one, like you say, gets a little bit quicker, a little bit quicker, a little bit quicker. So for event number four, once again, not a barbell in sight. It's all it's all rowing and handstand walking. And the time you spend on the row, or the distance, I should say, increases, and the handstand walk goes.
Yeah, it's kind of funky.
Yeah, so 400 meters in the row, 96-foot handstand walk, 600 meters in the row, 120-foot handstand walk, 800-meter row, 72-foot handstand walk. So the row goes up by 200 meters each time, and there's a little bit of a pyramid there with the handstand walk.
Yeah, and a lot of that has to do with the way it lays out on the competition floor. So this is one of those, you look at it on paper, you're like, what is this mess of numbers? It doesn't make any sense to me. But when you see it laid out, it makes perfect sense.
I'm sure,
you start, you start on the rower, you go down and back four sections on the competition floor, row a little bit further, down and back five sections on the competition floor, row a little further, six sections to the finish line. So,
so let me go back now as I look now. So we've got event number one was that clean jerk. Event number two had the barbell. So you've got event number three had no loading in it, and now event number four. So thus far we've got two events with no loading whatsoever, and you've gone heavy overhead for that first event with the rowing and the clean and jerk, and now you're going overhead, but you're inverted. You don't have the run, you've got a row. So it's, you know, it's not event number one, but it's cool that you've got a monostructural component and an overhead component. One was heavily loaded, one's just your gymnastic ability. So event number four is pretty darn cool. So what was the genesis of this one?
Yeah, a couple things on this. I love the combination of rowing hard and handstand walking. Again, I think the two movements tend to favor kind of different body types. So I think that's interesting. I also think, you know, there's a lot of speculation going into this particular event as to how the handstand walks were going to be done. You know, was there going to be some sort of obstacle? Was there going to be like a different skill mixed in at the turnaround or something like that? And it was a deliberate choice to say, no, it's just a drag race. Because sometimes one of the hardest things to do is have to perform the basics. Not that a handstand walk is basic, but you know what
Correct.
I mean.
Yep.
As far as what it could be, it's pretty basic to just go down and back. Being able to perform that when you absolutely have to sprint those rows, because they are the most significant part. So to come off and be just like, you know, emptied the tank and jump right into a skill like that and be able to execute it at a high level without making a mistake, without having it affect your ability to execute that skill, that in and of itself is a pretty demanding thing to do.
Well, let me touch on that for a sec here. And I don't know if you've got to be somewhere. I could try to power through the last couple here.
Let's go. I'm good to go today.
You know, I do like, it's always nice when you're watching something, you watch a competition, and every now and then, you want to see a little pizzazz, you know, you know, a monkey gets shot out of a cannon, like there's just something you're not expecting, you know, some sort of exotic movement or whatnot. But when I look over what happened at the semifinals, there's not like some exotic movement. You're like, hey, look at this amazing, like, no, it's a regular handstand walk. Mm-hmm. It's not arm crossovers or running step single unders or a rope made out of barbed wire or something like that. It's like we're doing five sets of 100 double unders, you know, like it's. Yep. It was this like the fundamentals in their pure, beautiful form, organized in a way to get to the end state that we want to get. And I think that's, I don't know if that was intentional or not, but it leaps off it at me. And I think it's pretty beautiful.
Yeah, no, very much so. The goal was to try to make these really, really stripped down, great examples of what CrossFit events are. And, you know, I think that if you take a step back, you know, I've been in the driver's seat for a couple seasons now with the majority of the programming. And it's funny because people tend to think that you are only going to approach things in one way or only capable of approaching things in one way. Mm. And Dave used to do this all the time too. You know, he would do something in a season. I can think back as early as 2008 when there was a chest to bar Fran that was part of the games. And everybody thought, okay, I'm only going to do chest to bar pull-ups from here on out because that has to be the new standard. And then surprise, they don't show up again for another, you know, season or two. Same kind of thinking here. I think I've been pigeonholed to some degree as somebody who's going to push the envelope on movements or skills or whatever. And to some degree, that might be true in some areas, but that doesn't mean that I don't understand, you know, the basics of what this can be when you just have to execute something flawlessly under a really difficult race condition. So deliberate choice from the beginning.
And how did event four shake out? Was it for huge distances on the handstand walk unbroken? Was it like, you know, short distance, quick shakeout, short distance, quick shakeout? Like what worked?
So the athletes had the choice to come down. They had to complete 12-foot sections at a time. That's what counted for the rep.
Okay.
So if you fell or, you know, stepped out of bounds within that 12-foot, you had to come down and restart. But for the majority of athletes, there was not enough time for you to be thinking about breaking. Like you had to be unbroken the whole way down and back, quick turnaround, right back to it if you wanted to be competitive. Because, I mean, the pace that people were keeping on those handstand walks was just phenomenal. To me, this was one of the more fun events to watch. If you're going to go back and you have limited time and you are interested in this sort of thing, go watch the broadcast on this event. And I think the final, those two were just so fun to watch because the races were so tight. You know, again, the movements were relatable for most of us that do CrossFit. Mm-hmm. And it's absolutely mind-blowing seeing somebody come off of pulling like a 135 on an 800-meter row.
Good grief.
And then go right into a handstand walk with no hesitation and be running on their hands to the finish line. It's pretty cool.
And that's such a beautiful lead-in, right? Because you're like, okay, yeah, sure. Well, that person's just a cardio gymnastics expert or whatnot. It's like, well, mm-hmm. what's going to happen on event number five? Because mm-hmm. here come the heavy barbells. We're working our way up to a very heavy barbell with the most technical lift that you can do. You get the squat snatch. So I'm looking at this one. I've seen it on paper, haven't seen it live. And maybe you can walk me through a bit more understanding of what it is. There's five different loadings for men, five different loadings for women. The barbells get heavier. Mm-hmm. For men, it's 185, 205, 2.25, 245, and then a final bar at 265 pounds. Women, 135, 145, 155, 165, final barbell at 175. And the way that it shakes out is you've got to do 10 squat snatches at the lightest load by the 2-minute mark. Then what, 8 at the second barbell by 4, 6 by 6 minutes, second to last barbell, I got to do 4 of those by 8 minutes. And then you're in that final heavy barbell, the 265 for men, 175 for women, 2 squat snatches by 11 minutes. So does that just mean there was like a running clock? And as long as you hit those parameters, you weren't, you know, kicked out of the event, so to speak, those sort of windows or gates?
That's exactly right. And so This was a repeat from a regionals event in 2016. And so that time, yeah, this is one, if you think back, this is one that Josh Bridges had like a great celebration at the end of hitting those big weights.
Okay.
And, you know, there was it's always cool to do a repeat to see how far things have progressed and to throw the modern era of athletes into something that, you know, you kind of have an expectation around. And to me, I think the really interesting thing that'll be unfolding over the next 2 weeks is just how the field responds to this. Because, you know, back in 2016, you had the handful of athletes that were at the high end and they made it through and it was this big dramatic moment mm-hmm. and you couldn't believe that they did it. Now it's like, okay, you know, 90% of the field is going to get through this and it's who can do it fastest that's the real separator. And that's pretty incredible to watch. So those rolling time caps that were part of the event in 2016, I mean, honestly, they were a bit of a mercy kill back then because it was like, look, if you're not going to get through it by that time frame, the chances that you have the strength right. to get to those bars anyway, it's unlikely. And we just don't want people standing out there on the floor.
We got to keep the broadcast moving.
That's right. Yeah, exactly. And so, you know, at that time, it really was more of a, hey, you know what? Let's just consider the fact that most people won't make it through.
Right.
But today in the modern era, that's not the case at all. And those rolling time caps were pretty insignificant for the majority of the field. It was all about, you know, racing on it.
I was going to say, so this was just a speed ladder as far as most people were concerned. They were just hustling, huh?
Yep, for sure.
Wow, crazy. And do you happen to, not to put you on the spot again, do you happen to remember a ballpark, like crazy time? Like how long did somebody clear all those?
Yeah, there was the Italian athlete, Elisa Fugliano, who I think, kind of shocked a lot of people. She was not the person that you would have picked on paper to win this event, considering, you know, there's athletes like Laura Horvath there and Gabby Magawa who are amazing weightlifters, you know, and obviously stronger in terms of the field. So Elisa Fuliano came out and I think she was just over 5 minutes to clear the ladder on this, which is pretty incredible. And she took the overall top time. And again, surprised a lot of people because she wasn't the one that people had kind of picked as the front runner for this event. But yeah, there you go. So just over 5 minutes for the women. And that's actually something that's interesting about this one too, is if you look at the loading between the men's and the women's, there's a pretty big gap. And again, if you think about when this was first kind of on the scene in 2016, I think the loading was appropriate at that time, given the fields. I think if this were to be reprogrammed as a fresh workout and not a repeat today, I think there's a lot of online chatter about this. And I think most people are correct in their thinking that we would put the women's weights a little bit more stout to be a better translation to the men's weights, because that's where the field is. This is the reality, is that everybody's getting stronger, and particularly the women's side of the house, I think, has caught up a lot as far as where they were at that time that it was originally put out there.
And it's cool. I mean, just a pure barbell workout again, because you've had two workouts previously that had no loading in them whatsoever. Now there's one with no monostructural component, no gymnastics component, just weightlifting. So that's nice to see that as well. And talking about your overall theme as well, as the times keep getting quicker. So starting off Sunday, event number 4, that was a 13-minute time cap for the rowing and handstand walk. And then, like you said, this one, people were doing it in, 5 to 10 minutes around there. So that's within that 13-minute. Now you get all the way to event number 6. And when I was piecing these down this morning and I saw the final time cap of 6 minutes, I just started grinning. I was like, oh, there it is. There's the bomb that's just rolling out there. So event number 6, pretty darn simple.
Event number 6.
You've got 30 calories on the echo bike. 15 muscle-ups. Is that ring or bar?
Ring muscle-ups. Okay. Yep.
30 calories on the echo bike, 15 ring muscle-ups, and then you're going to grab a trusty pair of dumbbells for a 72-foot dumbbell walking lunge. And does it matter how you hold the dumbbells?
Just farmer style or at the hang.
And that's going to be a pair of 100-pound dumbbells for the men and a pair of 70-pounders for the women. So again, 30 cals on the bike, 15 ring muscle-ups, and then a heavy 72-foot dumbbell walking lunge. Man, I think that's beautiful, personally. I think it's beautiful. How was one?
I'm telling you got to go watch the last couple of heats of the men's and women's races in France on these, because it was total chaos. I mean, you would see, well, and let me back up and say, it's kind of what we were going for, in the sense that we've touched on this theme of everything's achievable unbroken in this, but you're rolling the dice every time that you choose to do that. And in a race condition, when it's the final event and the points matter and it's all on the line, you know, you don't have anything else to do. We really wanted to encourage athletes to kind of take that risk and leave it all hanging out there. And that's what we saw. Absolutely. And in some instances, hey, it worked out great. They had the gas in the tank to get it done. And I'll tell you, there were plenty of other instances that were real heartbreaker moments. You would see people one step, two steps from the finish and lose their grip, or couldn't stand up out of the bottom and would have to go back and repeat that section. And it was chaos in the best possible way.
And there's plenty of athletes these days, which is so impressive, but there's plenty of athletes these days that can do a set of 15 ring muscle-ups, but you can also set a lifetime PR on 30 cals on the bike, and then that's going to change that. Did most people do a pretty darn good job of knowing their threshold of hammering the bike as much as possible, and you saw sets of 15 on the rings, or did they take like one strategic break?
Well, again, it depended on the men's and the women's side of the house. We'll start with the women's side of the house. There's some strategic breaks in there. There was often two sets for a lot of the competitors. There were definitely some that did it unbroken. On the men's side of the house, it was almost everybody going unbroken. So it was like, to be competitive, you needed to hit that set 15 right in a row, right off of that bike,
right off right the bike, the dumbbells. Man. Right off of that bike. And that's just another one where you're obviously, that bike has a huge metabolic hit because it's going to be a sprint. You're not being casual in that bike. This is event number six, trying to get to the games. This is pedal like the devil is chasing you. And then you hop in the rings, you knock out that big set. You don't feel recovered when you hop off of that. And then you get back down after just gripping those rings and you grab what probably feels like the heaviest set of dumbbells that you've touched in a while. And you have nothing but the finish line, your competitors, and how much you want to suffer between you and your game's dreams. And you literally have your game's dreams in your hands. And you were just lunging them to the finish line.
That's the old analyst in you coming out there.
Oh, dude.
it really did play out that way. And like I said, I mean, man, there were some, I mean, incredible performances across the board. And to have this sprint event at the end of a long weekend like that, where, you know, you still have the chutzpah to get after it like that. I mean, hey, it's commendable for all of these athletes. But that said, man, there are those that came to play and there were those that are also ran. And there were some heartbreakers that happened. I like I said, I highly recommend people go check this one out. It's a lot of fun to watch. The heats go by really quickly. And man, there's a lot of drama that unfolded.
And was there a lot of, like you said, the goal is to encourage unbroken. Was there a lot of unbroken for that final dumbbell lunge, or did you see a fair number of people that thought they paced properly and sometimes during the lunge realized they didn't and just had to set those suckers down?
Yes. I was actually surprised at the few number of athletes that were able to do the lunge unbroken. There were a lot more athletes that ended up breaking it up or were forced to break it up because of fatigue or misstep or whatever. Than I thought there would be. So very few people were able to complete that unbroken all the way through. Now, pop quiz for you, Pat, because I know to think about these things and you know, kind of figure them out. But let's talk on the men's side of the house. The winner of this event, I want you to give me the time that you think they finished this in.
Let's see.
And I'll say that he was one of the men that did do it unbroken. And actually had this really great moment on the finish line where he finished, was holding his dumbbells on the finish line, just giving the crowd the, yeah, I know what I just did before he put the dumbbells down. It was pretty cool.
Okay. All right. Let's say, that what's 72 is probably like a little over 20 meters of lunging. Let's say, you know, 20, 22 or something meters like that. So I got meters in my head. So let's just say,
let's call it 25.
Okay, 25 meters. So let's say,
which is probably a little long, but you know,
I'm going to just go real rough numbers here. Let's say somebody was on the bike for a minute. They were on the rings for 30 seconds, although I think they could be quicker in the rings. We're just going to say 30 seconds there. And then let's say 25 is it, if it's a second or 2 seconds per lunge, 50 seconds of lunging. So that's a minute, 2.5 minutes. I'm just going to say ballpark 3 minutes.
Pretty good, man. This gentleman crossed the line in 2:26 to to give you a it's absolutely bonkers. I mean, to just watch that level of foot on the gas. Yep.
2:26?
Yep.
I'm not going to lie to you. Now, I'm obviously not comparing myself to athletes of these.
Back up. I would challenge anybody, just a normal CrossFit athlete that has muscle ups, try to do that with walking lunges and let me know how it goes. You know?
Well, I was going to say, if somebody came onto camera right now and took you hostage and said, you've got to do 30 calories on the Echo bike, I'd be like, I'm going to need a couple minutes just to do that. like, let alone the entire event sub 230. That's absurd. Like, that's superhero status. Absurd. That's so impressive.
Like,
that's astonishingly impressive.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow. I like that one. I like that one a lot. And I might have to make a human version for Linchpin of that, because it won't be 100. Yeah. We won't be with a pair of 100-pound dumbbells. I could tell you that. But that but that thing, you know, for a regular person as well, like you're saying, grab a pair of 50-pound dumbbells instead of the hundreds. Do 15 chest-to-bar pull-ups instead of the 50 ring muscle, so you can rip the bike, rip the chest-to-bar, and go lunge. And see, probably feels like you get hit by Fran, and then think they did it with ring muscle-ups and a pair of 100-pound dumbbells. Like, that's so crazy.
Well, man. Pat, I'll say that that's actually something that's been really fun about this cycle of competition, you know, and something that we've been really trying to play up for the whole season is, hey, you know, one of the big differences between CrossFit as a sport and so many others is just, hey, the fan base participates. Like, we all do this stuff. We know what it feels like. You know, now obviously there's events that you just can't get in the mix because they're so heavy or they're so out of reach. Mm-hmm. But for the most part this season, there's been more examples where people can get their hands on these workouts and give them a shot than not. And that what you just said is a great example of, like, hey, you know, for a lot of people, okay, the 100-pound dumbbells are pretty aggressive, I'll give you that. But, you know, I'll take myself as an example. Like, I can take a shot at that workout with a pair of kettlebells or 50-pound dumbbells.
100%.
And, you know, the 30 cals on the bike, the muscle-ups, the lunges, I'll get through them. It's not going to take me 2.5 minutes, I'll tell you that much. But I can try it out and just get a sense in my head of what that gap really is these days between those that are doing it on the competition floor and the rest of us that are just trying to get fit. It's pretty absurd.
Well, and just think, this makes me think of, I mean, everyone who showed up there and earned their spot to compete at semifinals, you're astonishing, like period end of story. And then think, you're going to see just a fraction of them be good enough to advance forward. It reminds me of the conversation that just posted on VNR that we had with Ryan Davis, that D1 strength and conditioning coach there, of like, you got 1 million kids playing high school football, only 19,000 go to D1, and then only 1% of those go to the NFL. Like, you're seeing, when you actually see the people in the NFL, you see the people at the games, you are seeing the, I mean, what it took to get there, they are from a different universe. There's no bad athletes, there's no nothing. It is the cream of the crop. And so, kind of getting to look behind the curtain as to the screening process to show up to the big game, that's pretty cool. So I appreciate the glimpse into the mindset or whatnot. I guess in summary, everything that we've talked about, is there something that we left out, something we neglected? Any closing thoughts, parting thoughts?
No, I'm really happy with the way that this series turned out. You know, it's interesting because, especially for a big event like this, there's so much preparation time and so much time that you're kind of living either in your own head or in a proxy for that, meaning like a document on a computer somewhere. And you do your best to try to plan things out in a way that it's all going to come together and be great for everybody. But until it actually happens, you know, there's always a bit of an X factor as to if you hit the mark or not. And after seeing the first week of these, I'm really happy and I'm really proud of the team that we could put something together that, in my opinion, it really does the job well of qualifying the athletes forward to the big show coming up in the summer. And I know, like, hey, that's my job to say that. So I don't know if that carries weight with people, because of course, like, I'm not going to sit here and say that they're, wow, we really missed the mark, you know, but I do feel like, you know, this was a really successful semifinal series.
Very cool. I mean, again, thank you. We're going to, our goal, everybody, and hopefully I'm not shooting myself in the foot right now, there's two more weekends of semifinals happening. So, like I said, as we record this, it's Thursday, the 22nd. We're going to try and get this edited quick over the weekend, and hopefully this coming Tuesday it will post as the new show. And so there'll still be a weekend left, a semifinal weekend will have just happened. You'll have one remaining, which maybe watching this show will give you some really cool context between what happened the previous two weekends. And now if you get to watch that final weekend, you're like, I remember Adrian talking about that. So hopefully that helps kind of color what you're seeing and be additive to the whole experience. So much, much obliged, my friend. As always, for Adrian Bozman, I'm Pat Sherwood, and we will see you next time.